get impatient waiting for the presence. Now, what does impatient mean? Oh, you want the present. You're looking forward to it. You want to open up and see what it is. How many of you ever get that impatience? Come on. Only a couple of people that do. Okay, how many of you when you were 10 or younger did? Oh, okay, so you do understand it a little bit. Okay, just checking there. Sometimes we've learned, sometimes you have to wait. If you go to the doctor's office, you have to wait. If you go to the DMV, probably even with an appointment, you probably have to wait. If you want to talk to the IRS or Social Security, you're going to have to wait. Sometimes we have to wait. But sometimes the waiting is about something very special. We're going to see this morning the two people, a gentleman named Simeon and a lady named Anna, who had to wait. It's interesting. Simeon is told he will not die before he gets to see the Messiah. Now, I don't know about you, but if God came to you and said, I'm going to let you see the Messiah with your own eyes, and I'm going to let that happen before you die, would you wait for it? Or, okay, God, I want to die. Hurry up. Come on. I've heard some of you. Anna, even more amazing. Anna, the scripture says, was married for, what was it, about 7 years. And their husband died. Now, depending on when she was married, and traditionally marriage was somewhere between 13 and 15 years old for a girl, not much later than that, it says that Anna is either 84 years old or she has been a widow for 84 years. Now, that would make her at a rather ripe old age of over 100. So we believe that Anna, her husband dies, and for the rest of her life until she's 84, she's been living by herself. And she's been waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. The scripture tells us that she actually goes to the temple and she prays there on a daily basis. She fasts and prays regularly. She takes time to simply be in the presence of God because she doesn't have a husband now. She doesn't have a man that's going to take care of her. Who does she have? God. She has God as her redeemer, her protector, her caregiver to be there with her and for her. She has God and only God. What are you waiting for this Christmas? Some of you are waiting for that next check to come in. Or are you waiting for the third Black Friday? They just had the second one. Did you know that? Or another Cyber Monday? Are you waiting for those special deals that they said are going to come on Christmas Eve? The 24th? Or what about the stores that are going to be open on Christmas Day? I'm sure you can get some really good sales then. Or we all know the best ones come right after Christmas, right? When they say, oh no, they didn't buy enough this season, so put it down at a lower price and we'll get them in then. Are you waiting for those moments? Are you waiting for it all to get over, get past the 25th, so finally you can get back to normalcy and maybe even then see Jesus? What are you waiting for this Christmas? Are you waiting for that party at your house? That meal that you're preparing and there's still stuff to do and you're waiting for the guests to arrive? Are you waiting for somebody to come in from out of town that you haven't seen? Are you waiting to share your love with somebody that you've missed for a long time? What are you waiting for this Christmas? As I was thinking about this sermon, kind of asking myself some questions, I had to wonder, does Christmas get in the way of celebrating Jesus? You ponder that one for a minute. Does the activity of Christmas get in the way of celebrating the incarnation of Jesus Christ? Does your giving get in the way of Christmas? Well, I have to do this. And so, okay, good, there's another deal. Oh, I can borrow a little bit more. Oh my. Christmas time was never very many presents for us at our house. There was usually a game that was opened on Christmas Eve, something that the whole family could enjoy. I remember the year we got the carom table. Anybody remember what that is? Yeah, it's an electronic game, you know, computerized. And not really. No, it's got netted pockets and checkerboard on one side, and we played it all through the night, and that was the big deal that year. But Christmas has become what? It's become the time that we have to work on the economy. It's the job of all of you. Every year we have to spend more. It's a requirement. If we don't, we're going to be depressed. The stock market's going to go down. You're going to lose money, and things are going to be really bad. And we all know that, you know, everything is about the stock market and the economy, right? In a capitalistic, economy-driven society, much is about what do we spend, and therefore what do we give, to the point that we think that we have to do so much. Now, I don't know about you, but I like giving, and I like giving special things. And frankly, I don't like money holding me back from what I give. I want to give the best thing I can think of, whatever that might be. And so I have to kind of be reined in a little bit. And that's why what the whole Forgotten Christmas, the Christmas store, has really been a special thing for me, because it's a way that I can now give something that I know is going to really make a difference. Oh, I'd like to get that iPad, too, for somebody in my family. I'd like to get that brand new item that somebody else wants downstairs. I'm not allowed to say what it is. But, I mean, have you ever seen the Jared commercials? Come on, guys, don't you think, you know, wow, you know, he went to Jared's. You know, I don't know about you girls, but my girl, that doesn't do anything for her. You went to Jared's, what'd you waste the money for there? Giving. Does your giving and the time you spend on that get in the way of the celebration of Jesus? You think about this. Are you going into debt in order to buy things this year? Now, if you are, you're saying, you know, well, I don't want to shake my head because I want Pastor Bill to know it, because he's about to say something bad about that. I'm just saying, you may be giving beyond your means, and you may be doing something that's both harming you and going to cause you to miss the joy of Christmas. I remember the phone calls. And they came again and again. It would be a few months after Christmas, or maybe 6 months or so. And the refinance that my parents had done for that Christmas gifts were not getting paid. And if you've ever had collectors call you up, it's not a fun thing. And you notice that people try to avoid the phone or the knock on the door back in our day, because it's just not really enjoyable. If we are going into debt for things, well, you ask Jesus about that. Is it going to take away from what Christmas is about? What are you waiting for this Christmas? Luke, the second chapter, we're going to pick up the story as Jesus is carried to the temple for the first time, and he's being carried there to be dedicated. In fact, there's actually two things that Luke is going to point out for us, two things that are happening. One is the cleansing of Mary, and there would need to be an offering on her behalf. And the second thing is the dedication of the firstborn son. And it's a requirement in Israel that the firstborn son is dedicated to the Lord. You might remember Samuel, how he was dedicated to God. In fact, his mom takes him to the temple and says, look, I am dedicating his life to the service of God, and she will bring him back when he's 12 years old, and he'll live at the temple there to honor God through the rest of his life. Jesus is brought in a similar way. both to have Mary give the offering on behalf of her purification because she has given birth, and that's been, you all know, blood's involved. Secondly, she will now, and she and her husband will dedicate their son to Christ. It's what we do even here with our parent-infant dedications. It's a commitment of the parents and the children, isn't it? To raise a child until that point in time where they come to know Christ personally and make their own personal decision and choice to follow Jesus Christ. So we pick up the story in Luke chapter 2, and I am going to start at verse 20. Excuse me, 21. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus. Incidentally, remember last week we learned that it's Joseph who does the naming. That's very significant. Joseph believes the prophecy and the statement of the angel that Jesus is the Messiah, the anointed one, God, Emmanuel, God with us. And so Joseph does the naming, and he's there at the temple, and the two of them are bringing him. And the name the angel had given him before he had been conceived. And when the time of their purification, according to the law of Moses, had been completed, which was the 8 days, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or 2 young pigeons, depending on how much you had, you know, what kind of finances you had. It was a greater gift or a lesser gift. And Joseph and Mary are actually presenting Jesus, and they're saying, look, we are committing him. And it used to be that you truly did. You committed the firstborn to God. Well, Joseph and Mary do that. And Jesus is being dedicated to honor God with his life, and he will. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. What are you waiting for at Christmas? And the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord, the Lord's Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, this child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul. So there was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage and then was a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. And when Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. Simeon, Luke says, was waiting for the consolation of Israel. Israel, as you know, is under Roman rule. And they're not enjoying it. They have to pay taxes to Caesar. They have to do things. In fact, they risk their lives at times just because of their faith in God. It's been a tough time because it's been over 400 years since any prophet has spoken and communicated anything about God to the people. 400 years. Imagine that. Our nation is what? 250 years old? And yet it's longer than that, another 150 years. 400 years they've heard nothing. Yes, they go to the temple. Yes, some of them worship. Yes, some of them believe God and experience presence, experience God. In fact, you'll see that Simeon even experiences the Holy Spirit. But there has been no word, no message, no spokesperson speaking on behalf of God saying, I have a word from the Lord for you. The prophets have been silent. During this time, they've known, Isaiah talked about the fact that there would be a virgin who would give birth to a child, and his name would be called Emmanuel. And it goes on in another prophecy and says, and he will be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And they're waiting for that Messiah. In fact, each young lady during this entire time, in several hundred years now, more than the 400, has been hoping and praying that they will be the mother of the Messiah. That special favored place. But generation comes and generation goes and nothing happens. It's a dark time for the children of Israel. It's really, in a lot of ways, a dark time for many people. And the times that they're living in, the one good thing is that there's peace. And there's peace because of Roman rule. Or should we say because of the Roman sword. And the fact that the power of Rome caused there to be peace around most of the known land, most of the known world at that time. And it's into this setting, and at this time, that Simeon, nearing the end of his life, is waiting for something that God has told him is going to happen. Simeon, you're going to see a baby. He says, I mean, it must be something like that, because he says, Simeon, you're going to see the Messiah. Now, did he expect a baby? I don't know. But he says, you're going to see the Lord's anointed one. You're going to get the chance. And you know, just imagine what Simeon's thinking. There's been all this silence, this deadness for these centuries. And he's the one told. You know, this is almost as crazy as Joseph being told, your wife's pregnant and she's a virgin. And it's from God, and God's dwelling within her. This is extraordinary. But Simeon, because of the Holy Spirit's conversation with him, believes that is true. And he is waiting for what the consolations, interesting word there, the consolation, the comforting, the encouragement, or in other words, the exhortation from God. He's waiting for the message of the anointed one that God has brought peace on earth and goodwill to men. He's waiting, Romans says it this way, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. The word of God has hope for us. And that's what Simeon has been told. Look, comfort is coming in the anointed one. And it's got hope written all over it. How does 2 Corinthians say it? Praise be to God. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion, and the God of comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. Have you shared some of those verses with somebody when you're standing at a graveside? Praise be to the God and Father of compassion, the God of comfort, who comforts us so that we can comfort one another. Oh, again and again, I pray that for people, for the family members of somebody who's just lost a loved one, that God will comfort them so that they can comfort each other. And it's amazing to watch those suffering the most, those in most pain, are the ones who tend to be the ministers at that moment. You think back on memorial services you've attended, especially if it's a Christian. But you think back on those and look at how many times the person who has the greatest loss is the one who's reaching out the hand, hugging somebody, crying with somebody, encouraging and comforting them. And how is that possible? because of the comfort they are receiving directly from God the Father. And Simeon has been told he's waiting for that comfort to come from God himself, the Messiah present. I like what the way Philippians says it. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if you, that's us Christians, have any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one in mind. In fact, it goes on to say, and so then have this mind among you, which was in Christ Jesus, who did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself. How? Becoming a servant. And he says, we're supposed to do that same thing. Yeah, at Christmas time, when you're feeling worn out and impatient and stressed over, may the comfort of God comfort you so that you can give comfort to a world that desperately needs it. Simeon was waiting for the consolation, the comfort of God to come to him. But you know, Simeon's waiting took some faith, didn't it? I mean, he had to, think about this, okay? He's an old guy. Do you ever get tired coming to church? How many of you, you don't have to answer, were tempted this morning because it was cool enough outside. In fact, it was cold out there. It's frozen out there and frosted. If you weren't up early, there was ice on the road. Okay, now, how many of you, that blanket just felt really good this morning. And it'd be really nice just to stay there. And enjoy the warmth. You know, I got a feeling that a Simeon has gone through enough times at the temple that some days just didn't have the excitement that all the other days did. But what happens to Simeon? The Holy Spirit says, Simeon, you better get to the temple today. Really? Why? Because he's coming today, Simeon. So would you have gone? Or would you, ate too much chili last night. Thinking weird thoughts again. You know, I've been there so many days, it's not happening today. No, Simeon's waiting requires some very strong faith on his part as he responds. See, he has faith already that God's spoken to him and that he's not going to die before he sees the Messiah. He has faith that he will actually live long enough, however long that's going to be, to see the Messiah. And that the Holy Spirit is going to reveal that Spirit to him. He has faith, so he listens when the Holy Spirit says, it's time to go to the temple. He has faith that when he walks in that temple and he looks across there and he sees what? Mary and Joseph, because they had these white halos over their head, right? I mean, come on. We've all seen the pictures, right? They all walk in with this glow on them. So everybody kind of just saw that, especially the baby, right? No, he just walks in, he sees this couple over there, and what? And he runs over there, and he takes Jess, and he just grabs her and walks away. Now, see, I think that Junior would allow me to take her right now. The thing is that Joseph had no idea who Simeon was, and Mary didn't either. And all they know is this old crusty guy comes walking up. And says, grabs the baby, and whoa, look at this. What's he say? See, Simeon had to have faith that the baby was the Messiah, the anointed one of God, because he makes this great announcement. Look, the consolation of Israel is here. This is the Messiah. Praise the Lord. And he's celebrating. I got a feeling he's probably dancing, folks. Unless he was Baptist, then maybe not. I don't know. This is an exciting moment for him. And it's his faith that causes him to grab that baby and lift him up and say, thank you, God. And look at him and say, whoa. I'm bleeding, sorry. And he says, whoa. Thank you, God. Oh, my. Can you imagine being Simeon? The first one next to Joseph and Mary and the shepherds who came that night. The first one to know, because he's been waiting for him, to know that this baby He's the Messiah. Okay, God, I can die now. No, not till you give us the baby back, please. Okay. But I can die now, Lord. I'm finished. I'm holding it, sovereign Lord, as you've promised. You now dismiss your servant in peace. Oh, wow, I could live another 100 years. For my eyes have seen your salvation. Look, Simeon gets it, doesn't he? It's the Holy Spirit that's revealed this to him, but he gets it. This is not just a baby. This is salvation. This is the one who's going to bring life to the world. And notice how he says this: for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people. A light for whom? For all nations, for the goyim, for the Gentiles, for those who are excluded, for all people, and a light for glory to your people Israel. It's faith that has inspired and moved Simeon to see this is God. And I'm holding him, folks. I got a feeling he's not wanting to let go. I mean, he's waited his life to hold this one, and he sees him. Now, you see, Simeon's going to miss out on all the rest, isn't he? He's going to miss out on him coming to the temple when he's 12 years old. He's going to miss out on the fact that of him coming to Jerusalem later. He's going to miss out on him performing all his miracles. He's going to miss out on him walking on the water, healing the sick, making the lame walk, the blind see. He's going to miss out on all those kinds of things. He's even going to miss out on the cross. Yet he understands it. Salvation has come in God, right here in my arms. Salvation, which is going to give life, is right here in Jesus Christ. And what does he say? He'll be a light for the Gentiles and glory for Israel. I want to take you back to a couple of prophecies. Isaiah 42, where it says, I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I will also hold you by the hand and watch over you. I will appoint you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the nations, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the dungeon and those who dwell in darkness from the prison. Wow, that sounds a lot like another prophecy, doesn't it? Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, recovery of sight to the blind, to set the captives free. And when Jesus reads that prophecy, he sits down in front of the whole synagogue there in Nazareth. He says, today, this has been fulfilled in your hearing because he's the Messiah. Matthew chapter 4 says, the people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. That's a word for us at Christmas, isn't it? As we're getting ready for our celebrations, maybe we ought to be doing some repenting because the kingdom of heaven has come near to us. It's Isaiah 9, verse 1. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. This is because the Messiah is here. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations. Oh, Jesus out Galilee, oh my. By the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. That's what Matthew's been quoting. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice in the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. And what was Israel thinking? Yes, get rid of Rome. And what is Jesus thinking? Get rid of sin. Oh my, every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us, yes, a child is born. To us, a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the greatness of his government and his kingdom, and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal, the passion, the excitement, the thrill of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. And Paul said in Ephesians, therefore, remember that formerly you, how many Jews are here today? None. One. You're a Jew by blood?
No.
Oh. One. One. Only Betty. The rest of you? Too bad. No, look at this. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles, that's the rest of us. Sorry, Betty, we're going to need to join you. You who are Gentiles by birth, called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ. Do you remember? Christian, do you remember when you were separate from Jesus Christ? When you didn't have the hope of glory? Oh, you thought you were going somewhere special. But do you remember being apart from God? Excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise. Without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near. How? By the blood of Jesus Christ. For he himself, this little baby Simeon's holding right now, he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, that separating line between heaven and earth. Jesus is breaking it down by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. He came and he preached peace to you, to me, to those of us who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Betty, you and all of us. Because of this baby, Simeon is holding the salvation of God. Folks, have you seen the light? Have you seen the light? The light of the glory of God, that's what Simeon's holding, that's what he's celebrating, that's what he's enjoying, that's what Christmas means to him. Oh, have you seen the light? Then if you've seen the light, then stop living in darkness. John 3, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Have you seen the light? John 8:12, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Folks, have you seen the light? Are you following the light? John 12:46. I have come into the world as a light so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. Have you seen the light? John 1:4-5. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. So let it shine. Calm down. Let it shine. Have you seen the light? Let it shine. In the same way, Matthew 5:16. Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Next to every single person in this room are people this week who have not seen the light. And you, if you've seen the light, will be carrying the light with you. Now, when they look at you, will they see the light? You see, folks, what Simeon goes on to say is that Jesus' birth and his presence in the world, his incarnation, is the pivotal moment in human history. It's a dividing line. It's going to separate people. In fact, here's the way he says it. Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, and this sounds, you know, when you're listening to this story, you're kind of saying, wow, this doesn't sound like a blessing I want. Because here's what he says. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother. He's looking at Mary right in the eyes. This young lady who's given birth just a week before this now to this little infant who she believes is the Son of God. And she's marveling at all these things. It's happening so fast. It's incredible for her. And he looks her in the eye and he says, this child is destined to call the falling and rising of many. Oh, that doesn't sound very peaceful. This child is going to separate people. There's going to be a dividing line between people, for those who believe and those who don't, those who follow him, those who don't, those who see the light and those who don't. He will cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, the family of God, and to be a sign that will be spoken against. Oh, no. People aren't going to like him. People are going to speak against him. People are going to reject him. People are going to deny him. Oh, there's going to be people that are going to act like they like him, but they're not going to follow him as Savior. So that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. What you believe about Jesus is going to reveal what's inside your heart. And then he says this final statement, and Mary, you can just imagine what she's thinking. And he says, Mary, a sword will pierce your own soul too. Does she have any idea what it's going to be like standing there in front of that cross and watching him after he's already been tortured and beat and abused, and he's almost unrecognizable, and he's hanging there and he's bleeding to death. He's dying right in front of her. He's her son, and he's her Messiah. And she's going to watch as his heart's going to break. Literally, folks, the heart bursts, and Jesus finishes the work by dying on that cross. And a sword will pierce your own soul too, Mary. Do you know what happens when we leave Christ out of Christmas? When we leave the light behind, when we get caught up in all the decorations and all the stuff. Well, it's probably what happened back in 2005 with the Ridgeway Elementary School in Dodgeville, Wisconsin. They decided to have a winter program instead of a Christmas program. Naturally, school's not supposed to talk about Jesus. One of the oddest things about their winter program was that they sang Silent Night. Well, it actually wasn't Silent Night. It was just the melody to Silent Night. They changed the title of the song and called it Cold in the Night. Cold in the night, no one in sight. Winter winds whirl and bite. How I wish I were happy and warm, safe with my family out of the storm. Cold in the night. Oh my. They really got it right though, didn't they? When you take Jesus, the Messiah, when you take Christ, the Anointed One, out of Christmas, you get cold in the night. And Simeon gives him back. Here, Mary. You got this feeling that Simeon just kind of walks away on cloud nine somewhere. Wow. Wow. And this old widow lady who's been coming there every day, who's just praying and fasting, who's pretty much alone. That's why she's there at the temple. Who else would spend every day at the temple? She's there. And you see Anna. Anna was waiting for something too. She's widowed, 84 years old, alone, but she's waiting for the redemption of Israel. She's waiting for what she's missed now for years. Remember, kinsman to redeemer, the one who's supposed to come and protect her and take care of her, she doesn't have one. But she sees the kinsman to redeemer now. He's being held over there by this older guy named Simeon. She's seen him in the temple. She's probably heard his story, I don't know. She's knowing he's waiting for something probably similar to her. And she's waiting for the redemption of Israel, for the people to be bought back at a price that they cannot afford, for the Savior to come and take care of her and to take care of them, to deliver them what? This is what the redemption is, to deliver them from sin. And so Luke 1:68 says, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people, and what? Redeemed them." Hebrews says it this way in Hebrews 9:12. "He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once and for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption." What are you waiting for this Christmas? Are you waiting to see the light? What person living in darkness is waiting for you to show them the light? Yes, Jesus divides human history. There's life before Christ and life after. And he will show what people truly believe. And he will show what you believe. Father. Wow. Wow. You sent your son, the Messiah. You placed him inside of that young lady's womb. You confined him to a human body. And God, you walked here among us. You came to save us. You came to give us life. You came to give us hope, to give us peace and comfort, to give us eternity. Oh God, I pray that each person here today sees the light and lets the people around them see it too. Jesus, Messiah, we don't just want to gaze. We don't just want to hear the stories. We don't just want to sing the songs. We don't just want to look at the pictures. We don't just want to wrap the presents. We want to accept and receive and welcome you this Christmas. So we wait for you. And someday, we know you're coming back. I pray that we will be ready.